Hey, what's going on, everyone? Gareth here with FCP Euro. Welcome back to another DIY video. Today we're going to be working on this E46 M3 behind me. It is a recent acquisition of one of our coworkers here in the office. He's super excited about the car, but he has been complaining about some vagueness in the front suspension. Car does have about 130,000 miles on it, give or take. It looks like some of these components could potentially be original or they've been replaced a very, very long time ago. Even though everything still feels pretty tight, you know, you could still have ball joints that wear out a little bit. We're gonna go ahead and give everything a really thorough inspection, but realistically, we're looking to refresh the entire front end. So control arms, control arm bushings, the sway bar links, which, you know, these will make a lot of noise if you go over speed bumps or bumps on the road, they'll normally click, which could be annoying, along with the tie rods and the steering rack bellows. And also may potentially be installing these offset bushings as well. These are from the Z4M. It's a common option for a lot of E46 owners out there. These bushings are solid rubber, as are the standard E46 M3 ones, but basically the offset on these bushings gives you a little bit more caster or caster angle, which, you know, for high performance applications, whether they're gonna be on the track or something like that, more caster will produce a little bit more stability and also provide a little bit more steering feel. So these are a popular alternative, but we'll go ahead and get right into the video and we'll show you the steps on how to take apart the front suspension and put it back together properly. So some of the tools you're gonna need for this job are, you know, your basic metric size sockets and things. Like, you're gonna need a 24 millimeter wrench, a 21 millimeter wrench. But other than that, pretty much standard sizes from that point forward. Ratcheting wrenches definitely help. You want a pry bar, you're gonna want some hammers, but really, you're gonna want a pickle fork, a ball joint separator, big pair of channel locks to, you know, get those inner tie rod ends off. And, you know, if you're gonna be using an impact gun, that's also gonna help a little bit too. And some kind of penetrant is also useful. Sometimes there's corrosion on the ends of the threads, and as you're taking the nuts off, you'll be fighting the corrosion as it's coming off. So having this helps break that up a little bit and make removal slightly easier. But for the most part, yeah, your specialty items, pickle fork, big channel locks, Edeker clamp pliers, scissor style ball joint separator. And then from that point forward, it's pretty much all your standard hand tools that most people would have if they work at home on their cars. And then in terms of a possible other specialty item you might consider picking up is a CTA front control arm bushing tool. It helps install the bushing, but it also removes the bushing. So, you know, in the case of if you're ever just replacing the bushing on its own, that tool allows you to do that work on the car more easily than if you didn't have it. So we'll have that link down in the description and we'll be using this video so you can see how that works as well. All right, so once you get the vehicle properly supported and up in the air, we're gonna go ahead and remove the reinforcement plate right here, which is a bunch of 16 millimeter bolts. And that's also connected here to the forward splash shield. That's a bunch of 8 millimeter self-tapping fasteners. So I'm gonna remove the splash shield and the reinforcement plate together. Just a bunch of bolts, just try to keep track of everything. Eight millimeter. Also, when you're removing these bolts, this pan does have, it's a reinforcement plate, does have some weight to it. So you want to make sure its support doesn't fall down on your head. It would hurt. You don't want to do that. 16 mil. The back here, you have three 8 millimeter self-tapping screws you need to remove. They should just come out easily. You will drop one on the floor just like I did. That's normal. Before you drop the pan, make sure you have it properly supported. Probably notice it left two bolts in there just loose to hold it up into place. You don't wanna go rip these bolts out without properly supporting this, otherwise it'll come crashing down, probably hit you in the head, and it's gonna hurt, because this is actually a pretty heavy piece of metal right here. So we're here on the right side of the car. We have access to everything now that those plates have been removed. The right side of the car, some of them have a headlight level sensor on it. So you will want to disconnect the level sensor clip from the control arm. It's mounted here. You can usually get these released with a little flathead screwdriver. This one's pretty rusty, so it might fight us a little bit, but. So the easiest way to get these off is to disconnect this tab from underneath. you'll see it has this little lock going upward. You want to take a flathead screwdriver, basically depress that, push it apart. There you go. And then the whole thing just pushes right off. You want to do this first before you ever loosen this control arm, because you really risk potentially damaging the level sensor, damaging this rod, and you really don't want to do that, because I wouldn't say these parts are expensive, but why replace additional parts you don't need to? Next up, we're going to go ahead and remove the outer ball joint from the knuckle. I usually find it best to, especially when you're working on suspension stuff, remove from the outer portion and work your way inward. Reason being is if you removed the nut up here for the inboard ball joint, this whole thing would be flopping around, just be extra hard to work on. This is a stable part, this is a stable part, so I like to work from the outside to the inside. This is an 18 millimeter nut on this ball joint. We're just gonna break it free. Now, as we're unthreading this, it should come off relatively easily. I don't imagine the stud for the ball joint will start to spin because it is tapered. We are going to have to use a ball joint separator to get this out. So I'm going to go ahead and just get the nut all the way off, and then we'll get the ball joint separator and break it free. And with self-locking nuts, once you kind of get past the lock, you can usually thread these off by hand. Worth mentioning, this car is a Southern car, so it's basically corrosion free, which is kind of weird. Not used to doing that. Normally exposed threads would be really nasty to work on, so something to be said about buying a car from the South or from any area that doesn't have road salt on it. Control arms are not going to be reused or reinstalled, so I really don't care so much if I damage the ball joint boot. So we're going to go in there with a nice good old pickle fork and just go to town until it pops out. Pickle town, baby. The inboard ball joint is a 21 millimeter nut. Kind of have to get creative on how you're gonna get to it. But once you break it free, it's usually comes off pretty easy. And again, that's a tapered ball joint, so it shouldn't spin, but be prepared just in case it does. So once you get the nut broken free, you're gonna have to turn it a little bit at a time. I actually have this 21 millimeter flare nut flex wrench here. Works perfect. Plus, you know, you get a little bit different angle on it. Not normally what this would be used for, but actually, in this application, it works out really well. It looks like you should be able to get access to this from the top of the engine bay down, but you kind of can't. So only option is from underneath. And, you know, once the nut is loose enough, you can go ahead and actually get it off. Should be able to unthread it by hand. So again, ball joint separator, aka pickle fork in this case, and you're just gonna beat the crap out of it. You'll notice that there's a little bit of an angle on the subframe, so I recommend going with the angle since that's gonna give you the most amount of room possible to work with. And yeah, so BFH, pickle fork, and hopefully it comes loose. That ball joint actually separated very easily. It's a little bit of a narrower taper, so it tends to be slightly easier to remove. And then all we have left are these two 16 millimeter bolts back here, and the whole control arm will come out as an assembly. So next up, we're gonna go ahead and remove the entire tie rod assembly. 18 millimeter nut here, we're gonna loosen it from the knuckle first. So I am gonna use an impact wrench on this 18 millimeter nut. If you were home and didn't have impact tools, you would wanna go ahead and break this nut free before we remove the control arm, otherwise this wants to move around. For this, we're gonna go ahead and use the scissor style ball joint removal tool, 24 millimeter. So next up, we wanna go ahead and get the tie rod assembly, or the inner tie rod end, off of the steering rack. We have this rubber boot that protects everything. I'm gonna go ahead and cut these clamps. They are Etiker clamps, so basically they are the ears on them are squeezed, and that's what gives them the seal. I'm not gonna actually touch any of the adjustments here. Car is gonna go for an alignment, but I wanna try to get the parts on the car as close to what this is as possible. So I'm just gonna use the assembled assembly to measure the new tie rod before it goes on. Like these end nibbler type pliers for these, just mangle the crap out of them. Of course, this one was crimped in a shitty spot, but there we go. Yeah, these are some wise words. If there's a problem with the end seal on the steering rack, when you pull this boot back, there could be some power steering fluid, usually ATF or CHF11S, whatever the system's filled with, it might just come gushing out. So, you know, stay clear. But this one is dry. And now I wanna go ahead and remove the inner tie rod, which is right here. Just go ahead and use some precision equipment for that. Some big old channel locks. And so, you know, this is normal thread, normal right-hand thread. So lefty-loosey, righty-tighty. To loosen this, we're gonna go towards the reverse of the car, back of the car, rather. Grip on. And this inner joint, as you can see, is I'm able to thread this off by hand without moving the tie rod, so it's kind of loose. So next up, we're gonna go ahead and get our sway bar links off. This case, it's gonna be a 16 millimeter counter hole. There's two flats on the stud of the ball joint, which is gonna be between the boot and the sway bar link itself, and the nut is 16 millimeters. Should come apart easily. Like that. And that's the same thing at the top at the strut. So up there at the strut, could tell that the little link here had a tear on the boot. It's just kind of loose. Normally what happens with these is once you get like grit and dirt and water inside the ball joint, it'll just start making noise. So whenever you go over like a bump in the road, if you hear like a little click every single time you hit a bump in the road, more times than not, it's gonna be the sway bar link. And you know, honestly, these things could fail within 10,000 miles. They're also very commonly overlooked. So while we're in here doing everything else, makes sense to replace these two. So now we've got everything apart. Obviously, now comes the point of reassembly. I really hate the phrase of everything is just the reverse of taking it apart. It's not really necessarily the case. This particular situation, we need to press these new control arm bushings onto the new control arms. And a very common question is, how do I know which bushing goes where? Well, I say mirror the parts that came off the car. So we have our right control arm here. Bushing is still on there. Now we got both of our control arm bushings, which are pre-installed into the aluminum housings. But if you actually look at the part, this one says 65L, L for left. And this one says 65R, which is gonna be for the right. So we got the right control arm here. We have our right control arm bushing. And what we're gonna do is just essentially mirror exactly how it came off the car. Most important part is, as we're looking at it, you wanna make sure that this recessed area that's machined into the bracket, that needs to be facing towards the rear because that's what goes on the actual frame of the chassis itself. So you always wanna take note of that. And when you press these on, they can only really go on one way, kinda have a six-pointed type of grip going on in here, and that matches the end of the control arm. You wanna make sure when you press it on that essentially the lollipop bracket is even or completely parallel with the control arm itself. So can only go on one way, fairly easy. And we're gonna use this CTA tool to press a new bushing on. So just go ahead and set up the tool. It's very simple. This tool is actually designed to allow you to replace the control arm bushings on the car without having to remove the control arm, but it could also be used for pressing the new control arm bushing on as well. And if you want to use any type of lubrication for the bushing, generally soap and water works best. However, really with this press tool, not going to have to use any type of lubrication to push this on. It should just slide into place. But I'm going to get it started by hand, making sure that it's lined up. Just got to flip the little press adapter around the other way so it's not interfering with the bracket. The tool will basically center itself. 24 millimeter wrench, and we'll just go ahead and start tightening it down. The bushing will essentially press into place. Without this tool, you'd really have to probably use some kind of dead blow hammer, get it to go on, which really don't recommend doing. This is just a little bit easier. And like I said, this tool allows it to be done on the car, which sometimes it's worth just replacing the control arm bushings and not the control arm itself. $1 million question, how do you know when you've pushed the bushing on far enough? Well, there's a measurement in TIS where you're supposed to mark the control arm from the center point of the ball joint, of the inboard ball joint to the very end. It's supposed to be 299 millimeters plus or minus 2 millimeters, which is a measurement that you're supposed to look at. Basically, the way to know that you've fully pressed on the control arm bushing is there should be a little bit of protrusion of the control arm through the bushing, but essentially, once you have a couple of millimeters popping through, you're basically done. You don't wanna push it any further. You don't wanna go on too far because it could mess up the alignment. Just a couple of millimeter exposed on the backside, something like that, you're pretty much good to go. Step number one, we wanna go ahead and get the control arm bushing bracket sitting on these dowels here in the back here on the frame rail, while also getting the stud for the control arm or the stud of the inboard ball joint up through the hole here on the subframe. You could do the outer ball joint last, but you really wanna get these two sort of into place first. And then get it onto the studs. Easy. So the problem when you reinstall the control arm is the suspension is at full droop and the angle of the control arm bushing is going to be in its ride height position. So in order to get the bushing retainer to mount up with the frame rail, you physically need to flex the bushing. It's not a lot of fun. It's probably the hardest thing about reinstalling the entire assembly. It also doesn't help the fact that you need to have the inboard ball joint stud in place on the subframe, because if you don't do that and you get these in place, you're never gonna be able to get that in. So the hardest part is always gonna be dealing with this, getting the lollipop rack into position on the frame rail. So I have a pole jack here. What I'm gonna use this for is I'm gonna push up on the bottom of the control arm, specifically on the bottom of this ball joint here. And that's gonna put pressure on the taper of the ball joint stud into the subframe. That's gonna allow it so that when I start tightening the nut, it won't spin the stud. We saw taking it out, there's not a lot of room in there. So, you know, we gotta use the car as much as possible. And this is one way to help you thread locking nuts onto a ball joint stud like this. Then here comes the painstaking process of tightening the nut down. Just a tiny turn at a time until it's all the way bottomed out. There's a torque spec for this nut, but in all honesty, you're not gonna be able to torque it, not with the engine in place. So this is really just a matter of getting it tight. Also, I suppose if you wanted to make this easier on yourself, you could potentially unbolt the sway bar itself and that would open up this area, but if you could avoid doing that, recommend not doing it, just because there's a little bit more stuff to put back later on. So that is an option. Easy. We're gonna do the same thing for the outer ball joint. See how the stud is being pushed up and the suspension is compressed. The taper of the ball joint inside the knuckle will prevent that stud from spinning. And again, this is an 18 millimeter nut here. Won't be able to torque this unless you have a crow's foot, but honestly, with the box end of the wrench, you can put quite a bit of torque onto this and that's gonna be fine. We're just gonna go until the nut tightens up, like so. And that is done. If your car has a headlight level sensor, you wanna go ahead and reconnect it. Cake. We're gonna go ahead and install our new tie rod components, starting with the inner tie rod end, just bare. I'm gonna go ahead and get it threaded onto the steering rack. And then I'm gonna show you how I'm gonna go about adjusting it so that the alignment is within reason. But I really find it easier just to get the inner tie rod end in first and then put on the boot and everything else and then make the adjustment so that the length is roughly the same. I'm gonna go ahead and take the good old channel locks one more time. I'm gonna go ahead and tighten this. There's a torque spec for these, but you need a 38 millimeter crow's foot, if I recall correctly, for this. Tell you right now, sure, makes sense to torque, but almost everybody just does this with channel locks and it's perfectly fine. So next up, we're gonna go ahead and slide on our steering rack bellow. Basically just slips right on. There's like a little area right here, you can see where it's machined. That's just gonna slide into place. And then we're gonna take the bellow here and we're gonna slide it onto the steering rack like that. We're gonna take our Edeker clamp that was inboard and I'm gonna make some adjustments here to get it a little bit tighter initially. See if I can get one more click out of it. There we go. Take my Edeker clamp pliers. If you'll recall before, this was clamped in a very weird position. I'm not doing that again. I'm just gonna go ahead and have it facing down, which is the easiest way to have them. And we're just gonna go ahead and crimp them like so. Perfect. These make life easy. Then we're gonna take our outboard clamp. This one is kind of preset, so there's no adjustments you can make on it. We're gonna go ahead and take our pliers again and go ahead and just crimp it down. Pending, I can actually get it to sit. Oh, come on. Don't be like that. You're being like that. So there we go. Bellows installed, inner tie rods installed. And now, we wanna go ahead and get our jam nut threaded on. So on the original tie rod end, I counted about 9 threads behind the jam nut. This is not gonna be perfect. It's just close enough so you can drive to your alignment shop, which you will wanna do an alignment after this. 9. It's about 9 threads. Now I'm gonna take our outer tie rod end, thread it on. These are directional, by the way. They're labeled R and L. So when in doubt, just take a look. And make sure this collar is on because that's actually what squeezes down the outer tie rod end and helps maintain your alignment. Then we're gonna go ahead and take the tie rod. There we go. Angle it a little bit just to get it up. I'm gonna take our nut, thread it on. Exact same situation as the control arms. We're gonna go ahead and use the taper of the ball joint to keep the stud locked in place. The new nut is gonna be 19 millimeters as opposed to 18 for what came off. Sometimes happens. And you know, hardware is included with the tie rod assembly. Always make sure you're using new locking nuts when installing suspension components. Then kind of a similar situation, we could go ahead and throw a torque wrench on this. I'm gonna do that after I get this jam nut tightened down though. The jam nut here is 24 millimeter. The counter hold here on the inner tie rod is 13. Just gonna go ahead and take this jam nut and tighten it. So that the adjustment is locked in place. And like I said, it's not gonna be perfect. This is gonna need to be aligned properly, but we're just trying to get it close enough so that the car can be driven safely to the alignment shop. Torque spec for this outer nut is 65 newton meters. Try to get the torque wrench as straight as possible. Yeah, it's not possible. There we go. That's good. I'm gonna go ahead and put on our new sway bar link. It's the Lemforder replacement, just an OE. Only difference on these is the counter hold's a little bit larger than the originals that came off the car. So 18 millimeter counter hold and a 16 millimeter nut. 16 millimeter nut and an 18 millimeter counter hold. That worked out pretty good, actually. Torque spec is 65 newton meters for the sway bar link to the sway bar. Torque spec at the spring strut is going to be 65 newton meters as well. A little bit of goo right there, but we'll go ahead and clean that up. Yeah, so the process is going to be essentially identical on the left side. Just going to go ahead and go do that really quick. Like I said, exactly the same, so no real reason to talk about it. I ended up actually dropping the sway bar when I did the driver's side of the car, left side. Reason being, you have a bunch of oil cooler lines, power steering lines, really difficult to access this nut. So if you're having a hard time at home, just drop the sway bar by removing the four 13 millimeter nuts, and it opens up the engine bay a little bit more, makes it a little bit easier. Next, we're gonna go ahead and reinstall our reinforcement plate. So you wanna make sure and have this right side up, otherwise it's never gonna go on. So at this point, we got all of the reinforcement plate bolts threaded by hand. It's really important to leave everything loose until all of the bolt holes are lined up and you're able to thread in the bolts. There is a little bit of wiggle room. So if you tighten one of these bolts down and you think it's lined up, you might find out some of these other bolts don't line up. So just make sure you can thread all the bolts in by hand first, then tighten them down, and then we're gonna torque them. So all these reinforcement plate bolts are torque yield fasteners, 59 newton meters plus 90. Go ahead and make sure this is properly torqued down. So now that we've got the reinforcement plate torqued back down to spec, like I said, I actually went ahead and did the 90 degrees of rotation on these. I'm gonna go ahead and reinstall our forward splash shield, which should just slide into place. So yeah, that's how you would go about replacing the front control arms, the control arm bushings, the tie rods, and sway bar links on the front of an E46 M3. This process is gonna be pretty much similar for any E46 rear-wheel drive car for that matter, but the E46 M3 differs in the fact that you have the reinforcement plate with the double shear inboard ball joint. And you know, one thing that we talked about in this video specifically is that inboard ball joint nut that's up on the subframe. Really difficult to reach to. If you saw some of the B-roll footage, you probably saw that I dropped the sway bar a little bit on the left-hand side of the car as I was working on that. And I'm gonna tell you, that made it a lot easier to get in there with a 21 millimeter wrench. So definitely consider doing that. It's only four nuts, the whole sway bar comes down and off, and you have a lot more room to work with. And that's especially critical on the left-hand side where you have the power steering pump and oil cooler lines and all sorts of other stuff in the way that makes it a little bit more difficult to get to. But other than that, hope you enjoyed the video, hope you learned something. If you have any questions or comments, go ahead and leave in the comment box below. We'll make sure we get back to you. Go ahead and hit that subscribe button. We have plenty more DIY and informative content coming out to help you maintain your European car. And also hit that like button so we know that you like this content. But on that, as always, I'll see you for the next one. Later, guys.